August 3rd, 2020. This is Roqe. When it comes to some of the iconic voices and personalities of contemporary Iranian music, you can trace many of their sounds back to the arranging and playing of one very creative man with fingers that are the stuff of sorcery on guitar strings. He composed his first solo album at 13 years old in Tehran at a time when guitar music was banned, and he has become a famous name in Iran and the diaspora after appearing on over 150 albums since then. The talented Babak Amini joins me in the Roqe studio today for a very special interview. This is Conversations From, To, and About the Iranian Diaspora. I'm Jian Ghomeshi. This is Roqe. Hi there. Welcome to episode number 32 of Roqe. Khosh omadin. Hope you're all doing very well out there. How are you, Groovy Shaya?
Hi, I'm very well. Thank you.
I am stoked to have Mr. Babak Amini coming into our studio in a few moments to join us for a full episode. And he's bringing a brand new song with him that we will be giving the world premiere.
Wow.
Here on Roqe.
Wow. Well, great.
You knew that already. You're acting like... you don't have to act, Shaya. you have it loaded in the computer, we're about to play it. But thank you. Yes, wow, for sure, though. So we're excited.
But I didn't know that it's going to be first time that... I knew that we are going to play this song at the end, but I didn't know that it's the first...
The world premiere.
Yes, I didn't know that.
Yes.
Wow, great.
I mean, that's what he told me. I think it is. Well, we'll ask him in a second. He's going to come in. Did our last episode create some waves? It seems there are, in fact, many folks, as we suspected, Shaya, in the Iranian community who are not happy or comfortable with the designation of being people of color. Mm-hmm. So Banafsheh Akhlaqi, the human rights lawyer, the best-selling author, the professor of constitutional law, did an amazing job of making the case for why we need to understand, recognize, embrace our minority status in the West. You can hear all that on every and any of our platforms. And we're going to get to some of the feedback from that show on our Thursday episode with the Letters of the Week. Hey, Shaya, have you ever been to the Arta Gallery in the Distillery area in Toronto?
Yes, I've been there twice, I think.
It's a nice vibe, isn't it?
Yes.
I want to thank the folks at the Arta Gallery who are supporting this episode of Roqe. So this is a really fantastic gallery. It's been around for about 15 years, promoting Canadian and international artists. It's in this Distillery district of Toronto, and they've played a real role in promoting Iranian artists in Canada as well. They've also hosted a number of well-known Iranian musicians and actors and actresses and film directors who've had these talks and presentations at Arta Gallery. There's a great ambience in their space, and I know they have this motto that people should gift art for special occasions, rather than something more short-lived, something like ephemeral, like alcohol or flowers. And this is a good way, if you gift art, of supporting Iranian artists and spreading identity and culture.
Great. Actually, as you know, I live with a Canadian sculptor and artist, and he also loves Art Gallery.
Yes. Yeah. It's a pretty special place. And in the meantime, they are supporting Roqe for this week, and we appreciate that. Thanks to the folks at Arta Gallery. It's back open, phase three in Toronto post-COVID, in COVID, I don't know. If you're in the Toronto area, you can check it out. How was your weekend, Shaya? What did you do on Saturday night?
I had a great Indian food.
Yes. Yeah. But this is what I wanted to talk about. I had a few friends over to my place, and Shia was there.
Yes.
And we got talking about our last episode of Roqe and portrayals of Iranians. Mm-hmm. And I went on a rant about this old offensive film from the 90s called Not Without My Daughter.
Yeah.
Right. And in fact, the first time I ever got published was an essay piece I wrote for the York University newspaper at the time about how this film was so incredibly unfair in its portrayal of Iranians and stereotypes, etc. So Shia and a couple of others had never seen it, and you'd heard about it, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So we end up pulling clips. This is our Saturday night. Yeah, pulling clips off YouTube to see parts of Not Without My Daughter, and sure enough, it's even more horrible in retrospect. And almost every character in this film. The characters are Iranian, but none of the roles are played by Iranians, mm-hmm. including the lead male character, who is played by Alfred Molina, who is an English actor of Spanish descent. Yeah. And the only positive, I was showing you this, the only positive character in the film, positive Iranian character, that is, like in the narrative of the film, is played by the same actor who played Nehru in Gandhi. It's an Indian actor named Roshan Seth, who's a great actor, but it's just so, I mean, in these days of discussing representation, it may be time to dust off my youthful essay from almost three decades ago and put it out there again.
Matab.
Right.
You cannot.
Sally Field calling her daughter. Can't even pronounce her daughter. Yeah, that was the part you found most interesting. Couldn't even pronounce her own daughter's name. Yes. Anyway, not to do a promotion for the film. I mean, yes. Don't go look at those clips necessarily. But it was. We have a lot to discuss when it comes to representation at some point when we can do it for the Iranian community as well as as other communities who are doing a good job of bringing that to the fore. Enough about all that. Let's get to our introduction of the man about to walk into the Roqe studio as we do this introduction. Over 1,000 years ago, I'm told, a polymath known as Zaryab made his way from Persia to the Iberian city of Cordoba, bringing with him the music of his homeland, including a heavy dose of the Spanish form we now know as flamenco today. He's even credited with inventing the guitar by adding one more string to the Middle Eastern oud. Small wonder that our feature guest today should be so fascinated with the ancient music genius's path and has created a genius path of his own. Take a listen to this.
گریه کنم یا نکنم، حرف بزنم یا نزنم، من از هوای عشق تو دل بکنم یا نکنم، سفر کردم که یابم بلکه یارم را، نجستم یار و گم کردم دیارم را، نجستم یار و گم کردم دیارم را،
آقای بابک امینی امتیاز معروفی ندارم.
That is a taste of the works of Babak Amini, from his first film appearance in Qermez in 1998 to songs from the last two decades with Googoosh, Farmaz Aslani, and of course Ebi there at the end. Babak is a guitarist and a musical master born in Iran and currently living in Canada. If you know of him, you know the magic he can create with his fingers on a guitar, often delivering this exotic mix of flamenco shimmering with Persian influence. With over 150 albums, music videos, and film scores in Iran and outside Iran to his credit, Babak Amini is a highly talented and accomplished musician, composer, guitarist, and a member of the American Guitar Society and an instructor at the Canada Music Academy. After his move to Canada in the year 2000, Babak gave his first instrumental concert at the Ontario Science Centre in 2002. Since then, he's taken the stage at venues such as Wembley in London, the Air Canada Centre, the Rogers Centre, Honda Centre, Nokia Centre in LA, and the Forum in LA. Babak recently released his latest album, Babak Amini Project, which is a fusion and collaborative work with his flamenco roots to his jazz concepts in a new approach. Right now, Babak Amini joins me in the Roqe Studio. Hello, sir.
Hello, Jian. I'm so excited.
I'm excited.
And what an intro, man. I'm so emotional.
You have to live up to that now.
Oh, my God.
It's very nice to have you here.
Thank you.
Mon ami.
It's very nice to be here.
Mon ami actually sounds like Amini. I should also note that we are going to debut, we're doing the world premiere of a new song of yours at the end of this episode. I suppose, depending on how well the interview goes, you might retract your generosity depending on how things go. Yes.
Sure.
Let me start with where you are at today. I know you're someone who loves performing. I know you've been touring. Not so long ago, you were on stages with Farmaz Aslani on a tour. You had a bunch of dates booked still. You have you also produce. You usually have artists flying in and coming to your studio here in Toronto.
Yes.
None of that is possible in pandemic time. So how would you characterize the life of Babak Amini during Corona?
Oh, it's hard, Jian. It's really hard right now, and because, you know, we have two kids in the house, they are really energetic, and my studio is it's in our house, and so the amount of the time that I get for the recording is not much like before. But because I have a passion for so many different things in the music, I do different things. So I can practice still, I can make songs, I can work on the lyrics and different angles, you know. And I'm still busy, but not performing that much. So as you know, we canceled all our concerts, even the concert, the big concert that I had.
Yes, your solo stuff.
In Toronto. So yeah, that's my life now.
How hard is it to you, how hard is it for you to not be performing?
I love to perform. You know, I really like that preparation and working on myself, because when you perform, the technical aspect of the musician and the musicianship is different, but you have to work on yourself mentally, and your soul, your body, everything should be connected together to be able to perform. And I like that balance. I like to be in that situation. Performance is just one time. You have the chance one time to show yourself, show your abilities on a stage in that very moment. But the other things that we do, for instance, the teaching, or you can have in a little bit grumpy mood when you teach.
Right.
Even still in that mood, they learn from you. But you can be in the different mood. When you're recording, you can always delete it and record again. But on a stage, you just have one time.
I want to get to the teaching and yes. ways that you monetize your existence in a second. But there's also, you just told me this right before we started rolling here. I don't know if I'm allowed to talk about it, but you said you have news about a sponsorship. Can you talk about that?
Actually? Yeah. Right now I'm a Yamaha artist right now. They just sent me a couple of
great instruments. Just one of them.
This is new?
Yes. Yes.
This is, I mean, that's huge, right?
Yes, yes.
Yamaha's pretty much the the gold standard.
Yes.
So
yes.
What do you have? Is it like Tiger Woods? You have to start wearing baseball caps now that say Yamaha? What does it mean to
actually,
be?
Actually, I did today. I just recorded some couple of videos.
You've sold out completely. What was really what that? So you have to promote them. Are you allowed to use other guitars?
Yes.
Oh, you can.
I can. I'm working with different companies as well, such as Philippe Conde. We have good relationship.
You're not going to get a call from Yamaha if there's a video with you playing some other guitar.
No.
They just send you free guitars
because they are different kind of guitars. Yeah.
So wait a minute. You got a guitar today?
Yes.
This is an interesting charmed life you have. I started by asking how difficult is it in the time of Corona? People are just sending you guitars. It's not so bad.
Yeah.
When you talk about, you mentioned technique.
Yes.
And I'm always curious when somebody's at the top of their game, and we're going to talk about what that actually means in terms of your, why you are so respected and acclaimed as a guitarist. But how important is it for you to keep your chops up? In other words, if somebody is as good as you are, do you still practice every day? Is there still some regimen?
It's like any other sport, you know, when you want to have, because it's very physical. You know, when you want to be good at any kind of instrument, like a musical instrument, you need daily practice. But because I'm doing different kind of things, you know, I do arrangements, I do orchestration for the different singers, for the band, you know, I lead bands, and but I don't have enough time to do like crazy daily practice. I kind of adopt the way that I practice. I practice very short time, but very intense, mostly just technique.
What point in the day do you do that?
Not in the morning.
Why not? Why not in the morning?
I'm a little
Your
bit
fingers
stiff.
Are slower in the morning?
I'm stiff in the morning.
I see.
So I need a couple of coffees.
For your fingers to work?
Everyone.
All right.
Everywhere in my...
But you still, it is still important for you to practice. I'm imagining that there's students out there or people who are simply not as accomplished as you are, who don't expect that they have to practice as much.
I need to practice sometimes, you know, a couple of hours every day. But, you know, just practicing is not enough. Because when you just practice certain things, you get bored. You need motivation. I always learn something, research and learn something. And to master that, it requires some exercise time. You know, you need to practice to master that everything that you learn and research.
When you talk about teaching and you talk about filling the gaps in this COVID time,
yes,
I know you love your craft. I know you love music. This is a source of living for you, though.
Yes,
there are people, even people who are very good musicians, who have to have a different career, which is where they make their money, and then they do music.
I've been lucky, man.
Well, you've been lucky, but it also means that you have to survive with music. You have to monetize your existence. You have kids, you have a family, you have a house, you have a life. And I wonder, do you ever lament the fact that you have to do whatever it takes to monetize this existence? Teaching or playing on albums that maybe are not your favorite records? I don't know. Does it make playing the guitar and making music a little less romantic, if you will?
Let me put it this way. I was so lucky that I was enjoying all the angles and everything about music. So, for instance, some of the guitar players or musicians, like piano players, they just want to perform. I'm not just focusing on one angle, you know. I love teaching. I love to compose. When I compose, I like to learn so many things about the orchestration, to work with different instruments, work with different artists. So, because I love everything about music, I'm not limiting myself or my abilities to just do one thing. So that was the reason that I could survive, You know, I could not get very depressed about certain situations.
But does
situations.
It ever feel, you know, you're here to be Rook, right?
Yes.
You can't come in.
I'm
don't Rook. Be a Persian,
no,
you know, Tarof.
No, Tarof.
Okay. So it never feels like a job?
No, not for me. Even the projects that I wasn't that successful, I learn a lot. Hmm. You know, that's why, because I like to learn. There were some projects that I said, okay, I know this project doesn't go anywhere, but at least I'm doing something. I'm practicing. I'm working on the orchestration. Even if everything is useless, I'm working with the computer and new softwares. I'm learning to work with the new softwares. So many things.
Can I make a suggestion?
Yes.
May I suggest that you feel that way? You have that perspective because you've been through times in your life when you couldn't do the work you wanted to do.
Yes.
And we'll get to that story. But is that part of it, do you think?
Yes.
You know,
yes.
You understand,
yes.
How fortunate you are to be able to be doing,
yes.
What you're doing, because
exactly.
For a while you weren't allowed to be doing that.
Exactly.
Before we take a deep dive into that story, I've been trying to think of a Western equivalent of you. I mean, not that you don't play with Western artists as well, but a guy who arranges... plays on the songs, produces the records, is on the stage, is known. I mean, I really can't quite think. There are great songwriters, someone like Diane Warren, who arranged things, or Jack Antonoff. There are great producers, Quincy Jones, who, you know, you can sort of say, okay, there's a Quincy Jones sound, or he's worked with a number of different artists. But for someone who has been there, is currently with the icons of an entire music genre of Persian music, as I say, the arranger, the performer, the player, and who is respected. You're not really the second fiddle. When you're on stage with Abi, everybody knows that's Babak Amini. Do you marvel at how you became this guy?
Okay, it's rock,
yes.
Right? The moment that I grabbed the guitar when I was 10 years old, I knew that I'm going to be a good musician. I didn't know that I could be working with great musicians, great other musicians, and working with other mega stars. But inside, yes, I knew it.
Is it old hat to you now, or are there moments where you go, wow, that's me playing with every single one of the major Persian, almost every one of the Persian major Persian artists in the world? That's not a surprise to you anymore. You're at this point, you're
no.
Okay, that's good. Immodesty is part of being Rook. That's fine. You also, though, I was thinking about this too. You have a sound. It's a Babak Amini sound, and as such, you have had a profound effect on the way a number of musical icons sound in recent years. And by the way, they don't seem to mind. I don't hear Farmaz Aslani saying, yeah, but don't make me sound like the Googoosh record you made, or that. This is actually quite a power that you have, because you are shaping the sound of some of the major players.
Yes.
You must be aware of that. Could you imagine yourself producing an electronic album or a heavy metal tune or a hip-hop track? How committed are you to that Babak Amini sound?
You know, Babak Amini sound is not just a guitar sound. You know, I've done lots of records, lots of arrangements that they don't have any guitars in it. And as soon as you hear it, you know it's Babak Amini. It's just the way that I think. It's the harmony choices that I have, or the orchestration that I do, and the feeling that I put in the melodies, and like the whole package, maybe it's Babak Amini. That's why I put it in the Babak Amini project, and everything in the one CD, because I'm singing also in that album, and other singers, they're singing my songs, and I did instrumentals and lots of different arrangements. When I started recording after the revolution, Jian, I was the first session player, and that I start recording all the guitar parts in the studios, in like major studios in Tehran. You know, they were asking me, the old composers, Babak, try to play something like Armik, because Armik was like before the revolution, he was the session player. And like if you hear the old Googoosh or Ebi or Dariush albums, they're like all Armik guitars. I didn't want to copy that. And I was the first guitar player was playing finger styles in the pop recording. And I was asking them that, okay, if you don't like it, you can delete it. And I'm not asking for any money. You don't need to pay me, but I have to do what I think and what I believe. Mm-hmm. Anything that you see, I don't want to copy anything else. Even in a pop market, when something like certain loops or certain
yes.
sounds
yes.
start to selling,
yes.
everybody's using that sound. Everybody's.
But you've had this sound for 30 years.
Yeah.
You don't. I mean, there are artists who go on a wild journey of famous ones. Sometimes, you know, Neil Young went through a period where he's making electronic music, and I mean, his fans didn't like it, but you know, he needed to go on that journey. Or Dylan goes electric, or whomever. I'm sure you can think of examples. You don't get frustrated?
No. You know what? When I grow up, I learn so many things. Even that sound of the Babak Amini that you mentioned is growing up too. Hmm. So I'm not stick to my old version, you know, but that sound is still growing too. But it's original. I don't want to fake it. I don't want to copy anything else, like add to it. Anything that I feel that this is right for my music, for my sound, I do it.
I suspect for non-Iranians who would be new to this, somebody who's never heard of you, who listens to some of your music today right now on this interview, might be surprised, because it's kind of in the Persian DNA to hear the flamenco, the kind of those Spanish type of sounds. A non-Persian who hasn't heard this stuff yet might go, wow, contemporary Persian music is interacting with what I know as Spanish or flamenco music. Can you shed some light? I told that story, I don't know if that's a myth or not, of the Zaryaba.
Yes.
Can you shed some light on where this entanglement between these two musics came together?
I need to open up a little bit that subject. I am kind of new breed, I can say it, hybrid musician of like Iranian. When I was growing up, I was when I was teenager, I was listening to rock, but I was playing flamenco and classical. So basically, I love everything, you know. I have to say it, I was like a huge fan of Rush, the Canadian.
Yeah, nice.
Yeah, Canadian band, my favorite.
Before the revolution, in Iran,
when I was 10 years old.
When you were 10 years old, how you? Oh, so
40 years ago, I'm 50.
So 40 years. So that's around the time of the revolution.
Yes.
I'm just wondering where you got Rush from. How they piped Rush into the country for you, which is great. But
yeah, we used to have like tapes.
Okay.
And yeah, there was.
Have you met the guys in Rush? They would love that story. If Getty or Alex would, if you told them in Iran 40 years ago you were listening to Rush, they would enjoy that.
And yeah, and you know, I'm completely mixed of all the genres. And I don't like to limit myself. You know, I have my own sound, but not just doing only one thing. That helped me to understand like a pop music more, because you see lots of solid flamenco guitar players or yes. solid classical guitar players. They don't understand rock, they don't understand pop music, because they don't allow yourself to be open. They don't hear the good things in other genres, you know. That was my story. That's why I just wanted to open.
Okay, and let's continue opening.
Yes,
let's get into the Babak Amini story. Take me back to Iran in your formative years. First of all, how would you characterize Babak Amini as a kid?
I was a little bit nerdy, quiet kid. I was very quiet, yes.
Were you always tall?
Yes, tall and skinny.
And handsome?
thank you,
Jean. Well, no, I mean, you're it's not just me. Everybody says you are very handsome.
Okay.
You were always a good-looking kid? Nerdy.
Thank you.
Nerdy. Okay. You know the answer to that. You can.
I have to check the pictures again.
You have to reassess. You weren't particularly outgoing?
No. You know, I was a little bit nerdy and very quiet. I didn't like the very crowded places. And yeah.
Were you happy as a kid in Iran before the revolution?
Happy. Kind of. No.
You weren't happy?
No.
Why not?
You know, when I was, like 14 years old, I was so into guitar. And I was lots of passion and fire inside me. And I wanted to perform.
That's after the revolution.
After the
revolution. I'm asking before.
Before
when you
the
were a little kid.
Yes, I was happy.
It was a blissful life.
Very, very happy.
Great relationship with your parents.
Oh, always.
I met your father, he's the best ever.
Always, yes. I was blessed.
And you originally wanted to be a piano player.
Yes.
So why did you shift to the guitar?
I remember when I was coming from the school, my dad used to have those cassettes, piano cassettes, classical or different kind of just piano. And I was so in love, and I really loved those cassettes. And after the school, it was my time. You know, everybody was asleep or nobody was in the home. I put those cassettes, and I was thinking and imagine that I am the piano player. You know, when the crowd was like clapping and cheering for the piano player after they finished the song, I was bawling too.
It's kind of ironic given that you become a famous guitar player.
Yeah, but we didn't have the piano after the revolution. It was really hard to, and it was expensive and hard to have the piano.
And it was easier to have a guitar?
Yeah, my cousin gave me those little three-quarter guitars. It was awful, but he changed my life. Omid Kharadmand.
You have said, this is now getting into your teen years, I guess, because you've said, I grew up in the worst years for music.
Yes.
For you personally, where you were. It's a heartbreaking sentiment. Tell me what that statement means to you.
You know, when the government and basically religious government or controlling everything after the revolution, they closed all the music schools. We were not allowed even to carry a guitar or like any Western instrument. I used to put my guitar to the garbage bag
to hide it,
to take it with me to get a guitar lesson. And it was terrible. And as a musician, like as a music lover, we were scared. We were scared. We couldn't perform anywhere. We couldn't even say that I love the music. I love the guitar. I want to continue the music. I want to be a musician. Even like some of our relatives, they were like giving hard time to my dad. Said, "What Babak is doing?
Wasting his time."
Yeah.
Why didn't you give up?
I couldn't. The passion was too much, man. Till now.
So, do you remember moments in those years where you pretty much got everything going against you in terms of becoming a musician?
Yes.
Your first album, Grey Rain.
Yes.
You just said it. You wrote it between the age of 13 and 17.
Yes.
It's a remarkable story. It doesn't get released until you're 24 years old.
Yes, they didn't give me the permission.
So just for people who are not familiar with this this tragic set of events that a lot of people from Iran will know, you can, even as a teenager, you can write a record, but you can't put it out. You can't make the record, you can't distribute it, you can't even make a cassette without getting
permission
from some authorities.
Yes. And it was terrible, you know.
And it took 11 years or 10 years for you to get permission.
Yes. When I was 24, finally we released that album. And, you know, we used to record on those big tapes. And I recorded in the studio pub, they call it. That was our best studio in Tehran. And before the revolution, Googoosh and Abby, everybody recorded their best albums in there. When I released that album, basically it was the first guitar album after mm-hmm. the revolution mm-hmm. that they give the permission to release. Mm-hmm. And but I was so pissed off. I didn't want to listen to any of those songs because I was a different person. You know, mm-hmm. imagine I was making better songs. I had like two times better technique. So basically from that time till now, I never heard anything like from that album. Basically, I don't listen to my songs. But after the release, but especially that one, I was so pissed off because I was
pissed off enough that it'll bother you if we play a bit of it right now.
Don't play it.
Really?
Yeah, I don't like it.
Really?
Mess.
If I want to play a bit of Grey Rain,
don't play it. This is the first time, I don't know, after like 30 something years.
What? Really?
I never heard it.
Okay, let's just play a little bit of Grey Rain. Taste of Grey Rain from the album of the same name, the debut from Babak Amini that comes out when you're 24 years old in 1994. How does it feel to hear that?
Oh man, it brings lots of memories. I don't want to say what kind of memories.
Why?
But I remember all those time that I was going back and forth to that department, culture, art and culture department, and they were kind of ignoring me and not giving me the permission.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Can I just say that as someone who grew up in the diaspora,
yes.
So, you know, it is still, and somebody who knows these kind of stories, who has family still in Iran, etc., it's still astounding to me. We just listened to a beautiful and benign piece of guitar music. What reason could they possibly bring for that not to be released? I mean, what would they tell you?
There is no reason because they don't think that way. They think that they just think black and white. You know, they said that okay, this is a Western instrument, or the thing that you play is not traditional music. It's not from Iran, and those kind of things. You are reminding the old, like before the revolution, those culture, and and we paid for it.
But the way they get into the weeds, because by the second album, which takes you another 3 years to come out.
4 years, I think. Four years.
Then they're saying, the problem is that you're mixing drums and guitar.
Guitars, yes.
So guitar is okay now, but just don't mix it with another. I mean, this is...
I fought every little steps. You know, for the first one, the guitar itself, it was a major problem. Then I got the permission. And the second album, the drums and the electric guitar. And they were so... Because the classical guitar, nylon guitar, they were okay now. But after that, electric guitar and drums, they're like really Western instruments. Mm. Man, yeah, I fought every little steps that I took.
Babak, when you say you haven't listened to that, what we just listened to.
Yeah.
It sounds nice. Is it painful to hear it because of the memories of what happened in that era, or is it because you're an artist who thinks, oh, I could have gone to that chord better or played the...
Yeah, exactly, exactly. Two things, both of them actually. Especially for the Grey Rain, I have lots of memories that I don't want to go through it, because all those songs that I wrote brings up lots of memories. But for... especially my technique was, like, after a couple of years, was way better. And the way that I start learning and using the modern harmony was, like, totally changed my life. And
but you can't give yourself a break and go, I was in my early 20s, not so bad, you know, I got better.
Yeah, yeah. But, Jian, I didn't want to put it in the Spotify.
It is on Spotify.
Yeah, somebody else put it.
Who?
I don't know.
What do you mean? What do you mean you don't know? It's your.
I don't know.
Somebody put your album on Spotify, you don't know who put it on.
No, no. And Spotify said
meaning you're not getting the royalties or the streams?
No, just recently I just checked it, and Spotify said that, do you want to claim that album? There are two albums.
The album by Babak Amini.
Yes, I said, okay, I claim it.
But I'm not going to listen to it.
No. And yeah, but, you know, when I moved to Toronto, and after that, I went to Los Angeles, I did the album Magic. And that album presents me a little bit better. And after that, the Babak Amini project presents me better.
Just before we get to moving to Canada,
yes.
I'm curious about what's happening with your... parents at that time, and with what, where you expect to take this all, because by your early 20s you are known, as you say, you're a session player, you're known as a good guitarist, but from what I understand, even your parents were not discouraging you, but suggesting that this is not going to be a career.
Yeah, it was hard. It was a tough time, and I cannot blame my family, because my father used to say that, okay, Babak, you know that you're a good musician, you know that you can play guitar, just learn something else. So I cannot blame them, because the situation of the Iran, still you see them.
Yeah,
it's a crazy situation now. But so basically I wasted my best years of my life going to university and study industrial management. That was part of my life. I cannot say anything about it, but
When you say I wasted the best years of my life, it's such a heavy thing to say.
Yes, I have to say it, because imagine me wasting my good years, good time of my those years, instead of practicing guitar and instead of learning more stuff. Just going to school and, you know, going through all those exams and learning the things that I've never used it in my life.
So as successful a career as you have carved out now, you feel like had you had those years back,
no,
it could have been
totally different.
Bigger, better, somehow.
Yes. Wow. You know, I like everything that happened to me, because they changed me the way that I am right now.
Yes.
Maybe that pressure, those pressures that I've been through in the university, those pressures that the government gave us, we became different kind of breed, different kind of musicians, different kind of artists, you know. We have a saying that the art blooms in the limitation. When you have too much limitation in your life, you create things. And
that's a conversation we've had a couple times on this show.
Does
some kind of repression or even censorship or actually create the conditions where
more
interesting art can come out, because it by its nature has to be subversive somehow.
Yes.
And you believe that?
Yes, yes. And, you know, all those songs, it was part of my life, because everything around me was torturing me. And so maybe if if I had a very comfortable life and everything was supporting me, like regarding the music that I was doing and like my life, maybe I couldn't have those kind of melodies or those kind of songs for my album. Maybe I was somebody else. I don't know.
When you were at university, what was it? Industrial what?
Industrial management.
Not to take anything away from the industrial managers out there. I don't know what that necessarily means, but did your fellow students know that you were a great guitarist?
Yes.
They did?
No, yeah, because I had my albums. My first concert, I saw lots of my friends from the university. They knew it. Yeah.
And by the way, when you play concerts, this is all such a revelation to me, because you had to go through all those hoops to get the songs that are on the albums,
yes,
the authorities to grant you permission. When you play the concert, you can only play those songs.
Only those songs.
I mean,
maybe that's
so you don't even. I mean, so you would have to get up and play songs that you wrote when you were 13.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yes. You can't even play a song. You can't. There's no chance you could say,
no,
by the way, I just came up with something a couple of weeks ago. Let me play it for you.
On that time that we used to perform on stage in Tehran, only the repertoire that they gave us.
It's stifling.
Yeah.
Stifling.
And it was a terrible thing after that happened, because I used to sold up, like my concerts were sold out, even two concerts in one day I had.
In Tehran?
In Tehran.
Would you tour? Was there such a thing?
Yes, yes,
you
yes.
would go and play Tabriz or something?
Yes, okay. And you know what they did? Because they didn't want us to have concerts, they said that, okay, not only we have to give you permission for the like material, the repertoire, the songs, we have to give you the price for the ticket price. And they used to put a very low ticket price. So even when we sold out, we couldn't make any money. So that's how they, because so many musicians, they couldn't afford to have concerts and pay so much money from their pockets.
And are you politically outspoken at this point? Are you some sort of activist or something? In other words, is the only issue they have with you is that you're playing music that doesn't fit into the laws? It's not like you're a troublemaker otherwise.
You know, everybody around me, they know that I'm not religious, and I'm not politically active. So I was same thing back there in Iran. So anything is wrong, I say it out loud. But not the things that I don't have interest.
That's not the reason they were coming after you.
No,
It's just these just, qanun.
Just Babak Amini playing guitar, that's it.
By the time it becomes too much for you, in the year 2000, you end up leaving Iran.
Yes.
Before that happens, you have this fateful relationship that begins, musical relationship,
yes,
that begins with Googoosh.
Yes.
Who your dad was a big fan of.
Yes.
When you were a kid. So you're suddenly working with someone that you've heard in your family for years, et cetera.
Yes.
How did the partnership with Googoosh begin?
There was a festival in Iran. I think that they just did that festival one time. And there was maybe something around 40 different bands. And I played in that festival. And also I had my band and was performing with different bands, so I was pretty active in that festival. And Gugu's husband was one of the guys that the juries that they were voting for the bands. And
it was a competition, the
yes
festival?
Yes,
okay,
yes.
Okay.
And Mr. Kimiai, Masoud Kimiai, is a great director. And when we finished the festival, and we were the best band, and they gave me those trophies and everything, and Mr. Kimiai asked me, said, Babak, I want to see you, come to my house. I said, okay, I was so excited. I said, man, they're going to give me some like movie scores on this. And because I was so into getting some movie
scores.
And
so this is your probably, this is late 90s?
I was 28.
Yeah, okay, yeah.
And I was so passionate. And I said, okay, I knew that Googoosh is Masoud Kimia's wife. But just nothing in my mind was...
This might be about Googoosh.
No. And I said, okay, I'm going to see Googoosh, but my...
And you've never met her before at this point.
No.
And said, she's a superstar, obviously. Yes, yes. The biggest star ever.
Ever. Yeah. not in Iran, in the Middle East, everybody knows Googoosh.
Right.
And I was so into getting one of those movie scores, and so I was passionate.
Was this before or after Qermez?
After Qermez.
Yes, and I. So you've already had a little taste.
A little taste.
Because you know what somebody told me as I was researching for this interview, they said Babak was sort of known as a guitarist, but it's when he did that movie Qermez. He appears in this movie. That's when everybody was like, "Who's this cute guy who's singing the song in this movie?"
Because that was the first time after the revolution they show somebody with the guitar and singing. So I was the first musician that they gave the permission to show in the movie and cinema.
Okay.
So you're thinking
maybe this is with Roqe Kimia, I'm going to be in another film. Or
yes. I was so into it.
Yeah.
And I went to their house and we just had some tea and like we talk a little bit. And after that, Mr. Kimia said, yeah, I want to introduce you to Googoosh. I said, hi, Miss Googoosh. And I was so looking forward to get the music score. And the Mr. Kimia said, okay, I want you and Googoosh to have a little bit more conversation about the project. I said, what project? And started from there. And
what was Googoosh like when you first met her? I mean, how did it feel?
Nice. Very, very, very friendly. Yeah. And very nice.
You kind of hit it off.
Yes. And everything started from there. And they gave me some lyrics, which they were extremely hard to work because, those lyrics, it was like a modern Persian lyrics that doesn't have like a rhyme or anything. And I made music out of those difficult lyrics.
Were you intimidated by her?
I was comfortable.
You were comfortable?
Yeah.
And even though she's a superstar?
Yes, I was comfortable.
And older than you. You felt like...
Yes, because she was extremely friendly.
So, Babak, that's only... Within a couple of years, you and Googoosh hatched this plan to leave Iran.
Yes.
Which is it's a dramatic thing to do.
Yes.
Tell me about that decision. Tell me about how that happened.
You know, I'm really... blessed, and I'm happy that I made that decision because I couldn't take it anymore. You know, it was a couple of years, you know, 2-3 years before I moved to Canada. Honestly, I was waiting for any opening, anywhere that I can just move from Iran. I love Iran, don't get me wrong, but I love my people. That's why I still committed to so many things. Mm-hmm. Regarding my country and my Iranian roots, Persian roots, and Iranian mm-hmm. friends. Mm-hmm. But I couldn't take it anymore. I was thinking for the musician, like for myself, that I want to explore more and I want to do so many things. I want to be active every day. It wasn't the place for me. And I was getting through very bad time. I was depressed. And so that thing.
How was Googoosh doing at that point? Would you talk?
Same.
You would talk about this regularly?
We were like two birds with like wounded wings. Mm-hmm. And it was terrible. Terrible situation. I think she was totally more depressed than me. And we moved to Canada. And
well, wait a second.
Yes.
So what's the conversation like? Okay, let's make a plan. Let's leave.
No. The first thing that happened between us, I finished the album Zartosht, mm-hmm. and I made those songs, made that album for her, and they really liked it because the lyrics, I asked them, please change the lyrics because they're not very common lyrics to work with. They were very special. I couldn't show myself that much because of the lyrics. And on Green X album, they listened to me more, so they gave me better lyrics. They were good too, but they were different. It's not good. I told them that it's not good for the pop music, but they thought that this is the good lyrics. And basically, I think I did a good job working on those difficult lyrics, and I finished the album, and they really liked it. And that was the main thing that they asked me to be her band leader and musical director. So we moved to Canada together.
So forgive me if this is a naive question, but if you're Googoosh and Babak Amini, you're pretty well known in Iran. The two of you are this dynamic duo. It's a pretty big deal for you to leave Iran. For the people of Iran, for the authorities, I mean, it's going to be news, right? Yes. So how did you navigate that?
We went to the airport separately, not together. Okay. And in that time, Masoud Kimiai had a project. They wanted to make a movie in different countries, like out of the Canada. So that's how he could take Googoosh with him, and I went separately. So we saw it.
And you weren't telling anyone that you're moving for good. It was just like, I've got to go do a project.
Yes, exactly. Right. Yeah.
What was it like when you got to Canada? What were your first months like living in the West?
I love everything about Canada. I think this is my house. This is my home. And I don't feel like the moment that I came here, I didn't feel like an outsider, Jian. And that's why, you know, that I've been living in Los Angeles for 4 years, 4 or 5 years.
You moved there for a while.
Yes. And I couldn't take it. And me and my wife, Negar, we moved back again to Toronto. I think this is my home.
When you first came, you came to Montreal, right?
No.
Or were you came right to Toronto?
Toronto.
And did you speak English very well?
No.
So did you have any trouble
fitting
in?
I was terrible like now.
You're not terrible. You're excellent. But was that a concern at all?
It was terrible. Yeah. Because, you know, I don't have a good memory, so I cannot memorize the too many vocabularies and like too many words. But it was hard. It was extremely hard. Imagine you're 30 years old. You want to learn new language. And even... for the music, you know, we say do re mi fa sol la si. Here everybody says ABCD alphabet. They are using alphabet. It was like terrible. I had to change the do re mi fa sol la si to ABCD alphabet, and I had to speak different language and like.
But Babak, you're not just a new person in a new country with a new language. You're also a guy who is pretty well known now in Iran.
Yes,
coming
yes.
to a place where. The guy at the corner store is not going to know who you are. Was that a weird adjustment for you?
Yes. You know, it was a weird feeling, but I think I adjusted and I adapted myself pretty well.
So, because there's different breeds here, we've learned now, of very famous people, say even in the music category. There's those who were... who came to the diaspora and became famous here. There's those who've always been here.
Yes.
You know, like Maz Jabrani, somebody who myself would have just grew up here. Then there's people who have a big career in Iran and stay in Iran. There's people who come here, become famous here, and have this weird relationship like Hamed Nikpay, where he says, my audience is in Iran, but I can't go back there. But he wasn't necessarily huge when he came to the West.
Yes.
Then there's this weird trajectory for someone like you, who probably could work with whoever you wanted to in Iran, albeit given the authorities and all of that, but in the musical community, et cetera, you're very well known, coming to a new place and kind of having to rebuild.
Yes. You know, Jian, I started from scratch three times. One time, actually four times. One time in Iran when I started, it was terrible. And when I came here, I had the support from Googoosh. That was good for 1 year, because after that, when we finished the concerts and tour, I was by myself for years and years. And not having that hype, those concerts, and like 15,000 people watching me playing guitar or leading the band, I was just normal. You know, after the Air Canada Center, I went to play in a restaurant. People like having food,
and I was munching on their burger while you're doing some fantastic guitar riff.
Yes, and I did everything. It was hard, but because I've done it so many times, I know it. And that happened to me when I moved to Los Angeles. Actually, that time, and the Los Angeles was more difficult than the Toronto, because Toronto, they are more update, they know their artists. But in Los Angeles, the Iranian community, they are so old, and they are like third generation. They don't know the new artists. They don't know their artists. Yes, of course, they know Ebi and Googoosh and Sattar, but they don't know 30 years old Babak Amini, you know? It was really difficult for me in Los Angeles. But I started again and started, and that time I wasn't working with Googoosh, because Googoosh that time was working with different guy. And I moved back. As soon as I start working with Googoosh again, I moved back to Toronto. And because I wasn't here for 5 years,
I restart again.
So basically four times I started from scratch.
I don't know if you remember this. You probably don't. I remember it. In 2003, there was the terrible Bam earthquake in Iran. Thousands of people died. And there
was a fundraising concert.
There was a fundraising concert.
Yes, I played in that concert.
I hosted that
concert.
I know. Me and Nazanin Afshinjam.
Yes, I remember.
And I remember, the people were all excited about this Babak Amini. I didn't know who you were, because I didn't grow up in Iran, you know. But I remember the amazing thing is they said, yeah, and he's put together a band for this concert. I was like, who is this guy? I don't even know who he is. He's come here and he's already got a band, and they're amazing, you know. That was my introduction to Babak Amini.
Actually, that was the first time that I saw you too.
Yes.
Good memories.
That same year, 2003, is a less good memory for you.
Yes.
You take a trip back to Iran.
Oh, yes.
Why did you take that trip, and tell us what happened?
The main reason I was a little bit homesick. I wanted to visit my family, see my dad and my mom, sister. And the second reason, they released my album, The Magic, without getting any permission or giving, like asking me, or just released it.
Right.
And I was so pissed off. I said, when I'm in Iran, they don't give me the permission to release my own albums. That takes like 5 years. I don't know. But they gave my album to different companies to release it, but just without saying anything. I just want to go and follow up with that. And that was crazy. As soon as I landed, when I was in Amsterdam, so many people, they recognized me and said, Babak, don't go to Iran. I said, no, I didn't do anything. I was just a musician. And they said, no, man, if you go, they're going to arrest you. So they arrested me right in the airport.
You get off the plane?
Yeah, Mehrabad airport. You know, when you get out of the plane, there's a gate that they check your passport. They check my passport, but the gate didn't open. It said, man, just you have to wait here. And they called the guards, and they took me from there.
and you this goes on for a few months, right? You're basically
6 months.
6 months.
And I lost everything in that 6 months.
What do you mean you lost everything?
I had to sell my apartment because after that I couldn't afford it because I had lots of expenses and I had to pay so many different things. So basically I lost my website because I didn't pay, it was expired. I didn't pay for my mortgage and my car. Like my life was screwed when I came back.
And I'm guessing your friends and family were terrified.
Oh, they are terrified. Yeah, but yeah,
And I'm not anticipating something revelatory here, but did they give you a reason for why they arrested you this time?
Yes, okay. mainly working with Googoosh.
Your association with Googoosh.
Yes.
Okay. So I assume when you finally get out of detention and you come back to the West, you've made a decision that you're not going to try and do that again in terms of going back to Iran.
You know what? The experience was so bad that right now, even though I really miss my country, miss my family, if I want to see my family, either they come here or I go somewhere close to Iran to visit them. But
it's not worth it.
Not worth it.
And now you have dependents and you have...
But and right now, because they ask me and I sign that I'm not going to work with Googoosh, Ebi, or interview in certain TVs or certain radio stations, and I've done all of them.
I was going to say, so the first thing you do is come back and start working with Googoosh again.
And yeah. Right. So, yeah.
So your association with Googoosh continues. You guys put out some hit records, including Green X, you mentioned a few minutes ago, in 2010. I want to play a little taste of Menu Gonjishke from that record. This is with arrangement and, of course, guitar by Babak Amini. Take a listen to this.
اول و آخر حرفم بس که اسم تو رو خوندم بوی تو داره نفسم عطر حرفای قشنگت عطر یک صحرا شبانه تو همون شرمی
It's so good. It's so masterful. A little taste of Menu Gonjishke from 2010, Googoosh with Babak Amini. I don't know if you know, there's a video for that song that was directed by Ahmed Kiarostami. Of course, you know there's a video, but it's got millions, millions of views on YouTube.
My good friend of mine, Shahrokh Mishkingalam.
That's right.
Yeah, he danced. He did beautiful dance in that video.
How would you describe your years working with Googoosh?
It was fantastic. Fantastic all the way. And you know, we had a good relationship always. It was like few things about the management, and like, because there were so many things that were happening when we were working, especially the end of my work with her, the last concert that we did together. And they changed the management, and I couldn't get along with the manager. So I start feeling that it's draining, and I cannot take it anymore. So that was the story.
That's hard. Years of working together.
Yes, it was hard, but you know, I've learned so many great things working with Googoosh. She's a fantastic artist, but she gave me opportunity that I could work with extraordinary musicians. I could hire the best musicians that we can have, and playing and performing and leading the band in the most prestigious and fantastic venues that we have. Like Wembley, Air Canada Centre, like all those big names that you know. And yeah, I had that pleasure.
You know, I'd be remiss if I didn't ask, because few people have had the proximity that you've had, especially working as an artist with her. She is obviously an icon. What is it? What is the magic sauce in Googoosh? What? Because you listen to her, and there is something magical about her. There's a reason. It's not a coincidence or a joke that she's been as remarkably successful as she has. What is it from your standpoint that you think has elevated her the way her career has gone?
Even right now that I want to mention it, I get emotional, because I think that Googoosh also grew up with lots of pain in her childhood, and she went through lots of crazy situations, lots of pain, and when she sings, she sings with all that passion and deepness and fire, and that pain also. And that connects with everybody. Yeah, I don't know any other singers that can deliver that kind of emotion, artistry, technique, fluent technique, actually I can say, modern way of singing pop music. We have great singers, but I've never seen anything like Googoosh.
In the moment of, you know, when you guys would have a new song to work on, what was the you're officially the band leader, the arranger, and you're playing on the stuff.
Musical director.
So what are the mechanics of it? You would sit together and you would say, okay, Googoosh, here's the line. I mean, what is she bringing other than singing? Not to diminish the biggest part of what she brings, but is that basically it? You get everything ready and she would come and sing, or?
I wasn't only the composer working with Googoosh. Googoosh always works with different composers.
Sure.
But anytime that we used to work with each other, we trust each other so much that we could work very easy. You know, we never argue about anything. When I was doing like arrangements or orchestrations, she was very supportive, and she always let me do my job.
You know,
only one thing I have to mention, okay. those lyrics from Zartosh, even though I love Masoud Kimiai, it wasn't my choice.
Right.
Yeah. But the tracks that we did in Green X, like Geriye Konam Ya Nakonam, from Zoya Zakarian, or those songs that I did based on fantastic, beautiful lyrics of Master Ardalan Sarfaraz, Baghe Bibargi, and different songs also. So I was more comfortable with lyrics. So basically I could do better job.
I'm not surprised that you guys didn't get into arguments, because the only you I've ever known, and I feel like I know you personally, we know each other, you're very, you have a real sense of who self, you know who you are. I've never seen you flustered. I'm sure you must be at some point. Everybody gets, but I've never seen it. You always seem quite calm. Even right now, you're sitting here. There's nothing about you that feels prefabricated or like, you know, you're just kind of a, you know, you have a real sense of self and a calm sense of self. Yeah. How did you develop that? What can you teach us about being that way?
I don't know. Maybe genes from my dad and mom.
Were you always like this?
I was pretty calm and quiet kid, but I think lots of performing, lots of playing hard stuff on guitar helped me to be more focused. Like years and years and hours practicing and being focused, and I think those elements will help you to be more focused and more calm.
I like the analogy you called yourself. It's like an athlete. It's like, yes, a sport.
Exactly.
And the interesting thing about that is people don't always apply the same rules, even when they want to get good at to artists as they do to athletes, because no one would expect to be able to, you know, win a race without practicing running every day.
Yes.
But for some reason, some folks think, playing music or, you know, yes, or painting, or it's either a genetic talent or you do it or you don't do it. Or even with doing something like this, I know folks, I could do interviewing, I could do a show. It's not, it doesn't seem like artists ever get the get the sort of expectation that athletes do, that you got to work at this.
Exactly.
I'm going to get to your solo work, but in the last few years, you've worked with so many different artists, Farmaz Aslani, Siam Akashir Aziz, Hamed Nikpay, Abby. How do you decide who you'll work with?
Some of them I decide myself. Some of them just happen. For instance, I was extremely lucky to lead Googoosh and Abby's band at the same time. So we had a tour, Nostalgia, and it was amazing experience to leading those two singers in one stage and in one tour, and especially working with my dear Farmaz Aslani, which, and because all those songs, that beautiful songs and lyrics that he makes, is like more guitar oriented kind of melodies, and I could find myself more, so I can show my kind of sound and guitar sound on those arrangements. So my work that I did with Googoosh, some of them you hear guitar sounds, but on Farmaz Aslan is like just more like powerful guitar,
and he writes those songs on guitar,
yes,
some of them,
yes.
So that's, it lends itself to,
yes,
you guys definitely have something, yes, another magic going on there with Farmaz Aslani that goes without saying. I want to play a taste of a most recent collaboration though. This was a very interesting one. The great iconoclastic artist Shahin Najafi.
Oh.
I think this just came out a couple of months ago. First of all, let's play it. Let's take a listen to a little taste of Akharin Buse. Little taste of a brand new song from Shahin Najafi and Babak Amini. I'm sitting here with Babak, of course. I'm guessing that collaboration came as a surprise to some of your fans and his fans.
Yes. Actually, I have to say, I love that song.
It's a beautiful song.
And the collaboration was, for me, was full of joy. You know, I didn't know Shahin before. And I was thinking, might be difficult to work with Shahin. But I have to tell you, Jian, the most comfortable and fun collaboration that I've ever had.
Really?
It was so good. And we enjoyed it from the day one, and when we started, until we finished.
So the headline is Babak Amini says Shahin Najafi easier to work with than Googoosh.
No. They both are good. And but Shahin was so excited that I do whatever that I want to do.
It's a fantastic piece. I wondered, I heard you guys were working together, and I wondered what it was going to sound like. And it sounds very natural. It makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
It makes a lot of sense.
Very nice.
Somehow. You've been so generous with your time, my friend. It is It's such a pleasure to get to see you. We could do this for I would want to do this for hours, but I don't want to take too much of your time. But let me finish with some personal questions before we get to this premiere of your new song too, which I want to ask you about. And I guess reflecting on you, I want to think you've had an interesting year.
Yes.
I want to ask you about the fragility of life and even the fragility of your craft. What you do is physical.
Yes.
You work with your hands.
Yes.
You had an experience a few months ago.
Yeah.
Where you were on stage in Germany with Farmaz Aslani.
You fell down.
Yeah. You fell and you severely damaged your hand. I think you texted me at the time. I was terrified what was happening to you.
Yes.
And you must have felt like this could be the end of everything for you. Because your hands are everything for you.
Yes.
Tell me about what you've gained from that experience.
You know, the first moment that I fell down from the stage, I hit my head to the speaker also. So like for a couple of minutes, I was a little bit out. I couldn't feel anything. And as soon as I opened my eyes, I noticed that something crazy happened to me. And the very sharp pain start to, the feeling that in my left hand. The first thing that came to my mind that, okay, I might not be able to play guitar anymore.
Wow.
And the first thing.
You mean while you're lying there?
Yes.
You actually think that?
Yes. Exactly same time I was thinking about my family, my kids. I said, okay, I need to provide my family. So these two questions were the first thing that came to my mind after I came back because I was out.
Yeah.
And yeah.
Dude, you're laughing about it now. This is,
yes,
I mean,
it was terrible.
You were terrified.
Yeah, it was terrible. Yeah. And I remember after the concert from the Germany, which I couldn't make it, I went to the hospital directly. I supposed to go to London for the big interview. I managed to somehow, I went to, with the help of Faramers and Marjan, they helped me a lot. I went because I couldn't fly back to Toronto. It was like a very long flight.
Yes.
And I was in pain and I was like with cast and everything.
Yes.
So I couldn't carry any, even my guitar.
Yes.
So they helped me to go to London. So I stayed there for a couple of days. That was the worst couple of days that I could experience because you're by yourself, lonely in the hotel room, and all those crazy things and thoughts that are coming to your mind. And
how am I going to put food on the table if I can't play the guitar?
Yes.
Yeah.
So many things, but I could manage to handle it. I did lots of physiotherapy and like I went through different things and like different doctors and I practice a lot to bring it back. Even playing one note, it was extremely painful. I started only with one string because I couldn't move my wrist and I start to play only in the first string. And little by little, each week I added another string. So after 1 month and a half, I could be able to get the bar in the guitar. Couldn't get the bar. And after that, I was so, you know, if you have a saying, poor Ru. So poor Ru. So.
You were poor Ru because you thought I've got this. I can handle this. I can get through.
Yeah, yeah.
Did you learn anything about yourself through that? Did it surprise you how gavi you are? How much you can handle a situation like that?
You know,
it's pretty much when I heard about this. I think I even texted you this. It's pretty much the worst. It's the worst thing that could happen to you. Sorry, there's nothing for Babak Amini.
Yes.
To lose his hands is. That's it, right? I mean, it's you wouldn't want to lose your legs, but you could still perform.
Yes.
Yeah.
It was terrible, man. Terrible.
You've said that you've learned to live in the moment.
Yes.
And there was this other quote from you where you said, I've been dreaming of my future ever since I was a little kid.
Yes.
Which sounds like a very determinative, you know, we have a lot of A-type personalities on this show because the successful people tend to start early like you did. But that's the opposite of living in the moment, right? Yes. That's like, I'm planning my career since I'm a child. So how has that shifted? And what does living in the moment mean to you now?
I have both of them right now because, you know, I've lost so many good days just because of me planning ahead. You know, when I was younger and more nerdier, I was planning like 10 years ahead and I didn't want to get distracted from the life, you know? I was living in different world, just doing everything that I wanted to be in the next 10 years. But when you grow up, when you get older, you feel that you lost so many beautiful days, beautiful times that you could cherish more, you could enjoy it more. But right now, since I have two beautiful kids and my beautiful wife, I decided to not to lose these beautiful days and still planning ahead. You know, when is the time to plan ahead and think about the future? Strongly I do, but when I'm here with you and enjoying this beautiful conversation, beautiful interview, enjoying the friendship, for instance, me and you, Jian, I'm not gonna think about my next projects in future. So everything is balanced. My thing is,
you're saying during this interview, you haven't been planning your next steps at world domination.
No, I'm just enjoying.
I'm grateful that you've been here.
I'm just
in the
enjoying.
You have accomplished so much. I think more than that 10-year-old kid in Iran picking up the guitar could have ever dreamed of. Do you know what your aspiration is for Babak Amini in the next 10 years, in the next 20 years?
You know, I have to work on myself more. I'm sensitive, very sensitive. When you're too sensitive, sometimes you get out of balance. You want to have that balance more. That's what I'm working on it. Also, I got to the point that I need to respect my body. So I didn't have respect to my body because I was younger and just full-time working and working, not taking care of my body. Mm-hmm. So my plan for the future is respect myself a little bit more, respect my soul and body more, and do whatever that I'm doing.
A final question, Babak, and maybe this segues into your new song, because I know the title of it. So there's been an interesting pattern that's evolved in this interview. You know, this show is, we want to cover all kinds of topics and issues, and we want to reach as many people as we can. But it is, the focus of it is conversations from, to, and about the Iranian diaspora, people who have Iranian descent living outside of Iran. You're one of those people. Throughout this interview, you've called Canada your home.
Yes.
And you say you love it, this is your home. You've also called Iran your home.
Yes.
You said a few times, when I go back home, tell me about having two homes.
It's a story of our life, you know. I'm not just alone in this story by myself. You see lots of Iranians, they're here and working and having their life. And in their mind, in their heart, they are still waiting for the days that they can freely go to Iran.
Are you waiting for that?
I wish the best for Iran, for the Iranian, because they deserve the best. The situation that we have right now, nobody wants to see Iranian to suffer like this. With that much resources, like we have oil, we have so many things, and we have to suffer like that, it's not fair. You know, nobody wants to see that. So I hope someday I can visit my home country and I see good things and good changes.
You have this brand new song.
Yes.
What's it called?
A Iran.
Exactly.
It's so based on that beautiful melody of Iran. But the way that I play that song is to mix emotions and mix feelings that I have with the modern way of thinking that I do in that melody and in this arrangement. Hope everybody likes it.
It's been a great pleasure and a great honor, my friend.
Pleasure is all mine.
Thank you for doing this. Babak Amini, the composer, the artist, the guitarist, the band leader, the teacher, the scholar, the musical hero. This is a brand new song, his world premiere, Ey Iran, on Roqe. Mizun Bashin.